Welcome to my classroom. In this lecture, we will discuss about gas absorption. Gas absorption is an important unit operation. Actually, it is a mass transfer operation that is commonly used in chemical industries. Particularly, this gas absorption finds its application for combating the pollution, particularly to reduce the PPM level or concentration of toxic pollutant that is present in the flue gases coming out of any chemical industry process or even iron industries. Okay. Now, if we look at gas absorption, basic introduction, material balance, all that we have already learnt in chemical process calculations course. And this is one of the gas liquid contact operation. So in gas absorption also, a gas mixture will be brought in contact with a liquid, and they come in contact with each other, and there is mass transfer of solute A from the gas phase to liquid phase will take place. So that way, gas absorption is a gas liquid system, coming under gas liquid system. Fine. And while choosing this gas mixture, for a given gas mixture, what is the suitable solvent, how to make use of, because out of the mixture of A and B, we want only A to be dissolving in the solvent. That way it is important that we know what is the selection criteria for choosing a solvent for a given gas absorption operation, and what type of operation can take place. Gas absorption can be carried out in either co-current operation or counter-current operation, or which one is better. Okay, which type of equipment can be used, either packed bed is used or plate columns are used. So all that will be discussed in this particular lecture. And towards the end, we will derive an expression for minimum L by G ratio and how actual L by G ratio depends upon this L by G minimum. And we will solve numericals to determine the number of theoretical stages required to carry out gas absorption. Gas absorption. So, gas absorption is an unit operation in which one or more soluble components, you can call it as solutes, which are removed from a gaseous mixture by bringing them in contact with a liquid phase, which is usually referred to as solvent, into which the components of interest selectively, out of several solutes or several components present in a gas mixture, only the components which are of interest to us will be dissolving into the given liquid. So in general, this absorbed gas is then removed from the solvent, and the solvent liquid stream is subsequently returned to the system. That means the absorbed gas means here we are talking about the solute. Whatever solute A which is absorbed in the liquid, that has to be recovered or separated from the solvent liquid. And again, we may return the solvent to the system because we have to recycle the liquid solvent. Okay, so usually that operation is carried out in another unit operation which is referred to as desorption, or we call it as stripping, where we are stripping off the solute from the given liquid which is coming out of the gas absorption column. So usually what we are recovering here is there may be two primary interests for us. Once the liquid that is coming out of the column, we want to recover, and our primary interest is about recovering the solute from the liquid, that is different. Okay, there you have to mainly use water as the solvent. Okay, whereas if your interest is only to recover the solvent from it, then that is stripping. Okay, so the solvent recovery process is referred to as stripping. Okay, so what we are doing here, whatever is the volatile component that is present, that is will be removed from this liquid. Okay, so this, depending upon the purpose, the stripping agent that is in a stripping column, the stripping agent can either be air or superheated vapor. Usually steam is used to recover the solute and return the solvent, because thereby we either by decanter or by distillation we can separate out the solute from the solvent. Okay, so that is the objective here. So in general, any absorption column will be followed or associated with a desorption column, because what we primarily do in a absorption column is we are removing selectively one or two solutes from a gas mixture using a liquid solvent, and again that liquid solvent has to be recovered. For performing that, you make use of a reverse of absorption, that is opposite of absorption, which is desorption. So that is carried out, at least for regeneration of the solvent. Okay, we want to recover the solvent, hence that stripping off of the solute from the liquid is to be carried out in a stripping column, or you can name it as desorption column. So always an absorption column is associated with a desorption column. That's how an absorption unit will be always associated with a desorption unit, as you can see here. Okay, so usually an absorption column, whatever liquid that is sent in, which will be coming out, okay, so the solvent will be sent to your stripping section, where the solute or whatever is the pollutant like CO2, okay, that CO2 is removed from the solvent. So the solvent will be coming back, and that will be recycled to the main unit, which is absorption unit. So whatever is the CO2 recovered, that is further processed, or it may be sent as a feed or raw material for another product. Okay, so this is a typical flow diagram for an absorption and desorption unit. So what we have, we have an absorption column and a desorption column. What is feed to the absorption column? Whatever is the feed gas mixture that needs to be sent in at the bottom of the column. Okay, and the required solvent, either it is fresh solvent plus mixture of recycled solvent, will be sent at the top of the column. That will be sprayed at the top. So whatever is the X mark, that is where packed material is there, or it can be plate column, whatever. So we have this thing. So actually mass transfer is taking place, that is dissolution of solute A from gas phase to liquid phase is taking place. So this is an example of A diffusing in B and B non-diffusive. Okay, that is unimolecular diffusion is taking place in case of gas absorption. So in gas absorption, unimolecular diffusion of A from one phase to another phase is taking place, from gas phase to liquid phase is taking place. Okay, so essentially you have a gas mixture. Okay, when I say gas mixture, it is a mixture of, when I say gas mixture, it can be a mixture of A, B plus C plus D. So whatever is solute A only has to be dissolved using a solvent. Okay, so we will come in, this is gas and this is liquid. So from gas to liquid, only A will be dissolving. So what is the remaining thing? So that remaining thing is called as carrier gas. Okay, so the remaining thing is called as carrier gas. So okay, what is carrier gas? So the gas mixture which carries the solute A is called carrier gas. Okay, that means the rest of A, if A is the solute, the rest of A is called as rest of A. What is that rest of A? It is B, C, D, if it is a four component system. Okay, they are called as carrier gas. Okay, so here the mass transfer or the interaction is taking place in a gas liquid system or gas liquid contactor. Either this contactor can be a packed column or a plate column. So the mass transfer is taking place between gas and liquid, and particularly solute A from gas phase is diffusing into liquid. Okay, so that's what takes place. So examples, industrial examples, there are ample examples available. Primarily, as I said, the pollutants or whatever is toxic or corrosive or which causes more pollution to the water bodies or air, that needs to be reduced. The component, the ppm level or the concentration of such pollutant in the water as well as the air which is living in any industry needs to be controlled. Okay, so that way, if you look at ammonia has to be removed from the oven gas using water as the solvent. So here ammonia is the solute, oven gas, whatever is the rest of the component, is the carrier gas, and water is the solvent, or you can say absorbent. Water is absorbing the solute from the zone. So the liquid solvent is called as absorbent. Okay. Another example is removal of CO2 or H2S from the natural gas using water solutions of alkaline soils. Say if alkanol amines like ethanolamine, methanolamine are used as the absorbent or liquid solvent to recover or separate out CO2 and H2S from the natural gas. Actually, removal of H2S from the natural gas is called as sweetening. Okay, that is mentioned here. Sweetening of H2S. Okay, during that some reactions may also take place. When a reaction is associated with absorption, in that case it is called chemical absorption. If not, they are referred to as physical absorption. Okay, that is learnt in school itself, right? There can be weak van der Waals forces only contributing to the absorption, that is our adsorption. So we have physical and chemical. Some chemical reaction is associated with it. It is called chemical absorption. Okay. So another example is removal of benzene or toluene from the natural gas using hydrocarbon oil. So here hydrocarbon oil is the absorbent or solvent. Benzene and toluene are the solute which needs to be removed. Natural gas is the carrier gas. Okay, another example. These are only with respect to chemical engineering. But in general, in nature, we have several phenomena that is taking place, which is also again gas absorption in the liquid. For example, water bodies across the lake. Okay, any a lake is there or sea is there. Oxygen from the air concentration is more. Oxygen in the water, any water body is less. So obviously there is difference in concentration. So always gas absorption, that is oxygen is getting absorbed by the water, and that is how water is available for the aquatic life like fish, etc. Tortoise, all that has to live. So they need oxygen. That oxygen is getting into the water only by absorption of oxygen by the water bodies across the earth from the air. Okay, so here air is the carrier gas, solute is oxygen, and the water body is the solvent there. Okay, and as well as I have explained to you earlier also, when we are breathing, when we are inhaling oxygen, through oxygen is getting into us and it is reaching our blood through absorption. Okay, that is also an example for gas absorption. So that way we have more practical application for gas absorptions. Either we may know it or we may not know it, but there are several examples we are in our daily life we come across absorption of gas into liquids. Okay, and if you look at a specific industrial example, I am more practical person, I want to become a core industry job, please give me example for industries where these gas absorptions are used so that I can try for internship or placements. There are ample examples here. You can see that even in the paper pulp industries, in wood industries, this SO2 level has to be reduced. So in the glass production also, so the removal of SO2 is being done from the gases, so using water as the solvent. If you look at the carbon making industries, there are also removal of CO2, and so water is used as a solvent, or even acetone or K2CO3 are used as the solvent. Okay, so if you look at the sulfuric acid production industry, because it is major chemical that is being produced are sulfuric acid and nitric acid, right? So if you look at those industries, there also SO3 has to be reduced. Okay, so for that we even use sulfuric acid is used as a solvent or absorbent, which will absorb this SO3 to get into to absorb SO3 from the stream that is leaving. Okay, even in the nitric acid production units, NOx has to be reduced from the gas that is leaving the system. So that way water, either we can use water as a solvent. Okay, and another major chemical is hydrochloric acid production. So if you look at hydrochloric acid production plants, HCl has to be recovered from the stream that is leaving. So water is again used as a solvent. See, remember, water is an universal solvent. I just said water is the universal solvent which is cheaply available. Okay. So this is conventionally used to remove ammonia from the gas stream, which contains 1 to 5% of ammonia. Okay. and this process is usually highly exothermic, and whatever is the energy effect accompanying this absorption process has to be taken into account when we are performing the design calculation. When it is highly exothermic, we have to maintain the temperature, right? So for that we should take care of design where we will have cooling coils, or whether we should have jacketed kettle type setups should be ensured, so that we maintain our absorption operation at a particular temperature and pressure. Okay, and there are other examples other than removal of ammonia from the flue gases. So we have absorption of hydrochloric acid present at low concentration in the gas stream using some water wash tower. Okay, so like venturi scrubber type of towers we can make use to absorb the small amount of hydrochloric acid present in low concentrations in the gas streams. Other example is absorption of CO2 using ethanol amines is an example, or sweetening of natural gas, that is removal of H2S from natural gas using solvents is example. Okay, and what is the significance of this? What is the importance, significance of this absorption column? Some students ask, so I want to go for core job. What is the practical aspect of this? Whatever we learn in the courses, can you explain? Okay, so for that, if you consider the market survey for this particular absorption unit, what is the scope for absorption operations? Okay, so usually absorbers are ready-made available. Okay, the technology is well developed. Okay, still improvements are being carried out. So it is widely being used in chemical process industries and even other industries also. So this chemical industry mainly uses absorbers mainly to capture the acid gases like HCl or small amount of sulfuric acid kind of things, okay, or sulfur dioxide or hydrogen chloride, etc., which are released in various processing stream. Okay, either it can be released in unit operation or in unit processes. Okay, and other plating industries, electroplating or coating industries, they also use absorbers to capture the fumes from the plating tanks. Whatever fume is there, that may be carrying some of the components which needs to be removed before letting it go into the atmosphere. Okay, even the food industries wants to eliminate the odorous emissions which are coming out for using some absorbers. Okay, food industries, any fish kind of smell, we want to reduce the odor before we let the gas or air enter into the atmosphere, right? And there are other major purchases like pulp industries, mining industries, steel mills, waste to energy plants. All these places we have absorption unit operation present there. So there is a wide scope for absorption plants to be used in these industries. Okay, and there are several industries which are being built across the globe. We have 36% of this percentage purchase is there in this year. You can see the table, what is the revenue for absorption column across the countries. You can see even in Asia, West Asia, okay, in East Asia, the dollars is like $1,046 million, or in West Asia it is $190 million. Across the world, total is around, you can see $2,886 million is being the business for this absorption column. Mainly this absorption column, two major applications which are being reported are from power plants. In power plant, whatever may be the source of power generation, particularly coal, if the power generation is from coal or ignite, okay, so in these coal-fired generators, they have gases in which we have to reduce the toxic pollutant level which is leaving the system, right? So there we mainly use absorption columns. Okay, and either they may be using either a spray tower or plate tower. As I said, this gas liquid contactor, absorption is carried out in a gas liquid contactor. So we may use either spray towers, that is tray tower, all these places we can make use. Okay, so that way even packed towers can be used or plate columns can be used. Another major application that is reported in the global market is you performing ozone, using ozone or oxidation. Okay, using ozone and oxidation chemicals to convert the NOx toxic pollutants into some less pollutant, less, or you can say safe chemical. They are getting converted into some more safe chemicals. For example, if you consider VOCs, that is volatile organic chemicals, they are used to react with oxygen or ozone to form CO2 and water, or you can say H2S is there. Again, when it is reacted with ozone, we have volatile organic chemicals are reacted with ozone to form CO2 and water. Similarly, H2S is reacted with ozone to form SO2, or even mercury plus ozone gives HGO. Okay, so that reduces the odor, poor odor. Okay, so if you look at the major producers of these absorption columns, you can see the Linde group, Munich, Germany, they are having a patented system which combines this ozone generated with a scrubber that would absorb the soluble NO2 created by the NOx reaction with the ozone. Okay, so this is actually licensed to DuPont. So they are selling so many number of systems for major petrochemical industries. Okay, so wherever petrochemical industries are there, they are supplying this type of system which involves absorption. Okay, and there are even places, no, shipping, because in ships also we need whatever jet fuel that is being used, they want to reduce the sulfur content, because the fuel that they are using is containing a sulfur content highest 4%. Okay, that means the industry emits around 12 million tons per year of SO2 in the shipping industry. That means when the ship is moving across the oceans, they are emitting so much million tons of SO2. Now countries are taking some legislative measures such that the ship should reduce the emission. So that way, what they have, brine water they are having, right? So the absorption system which it should work with using seawater as the solvent. Okay, so using seawater as a solvent, how efficiently we can reduce the SOx content from the gases. Okay, so that way that depends upon the economics that will be dictating either the purchase of absorber which uses seawater as a scrubbing ligand, but it is having a large scope. Okay, now coming back to this course, we have to make use of several solvents are available. As I said, even recent research is being done to show the brine as the solvent. So water is a universal solvent which is widely being used, and if you want to have better removal rate, so if some other chemical is having more solubility, that is when the solute is having more solubility towards the solvent, then that solvent can be made use first the absorber. Okay, so for example, this alkanol amines like methanol amine, ethanol amine is being used, or you can say mono ethanol amines, diethanol amines. Within that ethanol amine, we have monoethanol or diethanol amines can be used, or glycols is being used, diethylene glycol or triethylene glycol are being used as a solvent. And for a specific application, it all depends upon the system. For a given system, one solvent may be more. So how to choose a solvent, we will discuss later. Okay, for a given system, what should be my solvent can be discussed later. Okay, so sometimes we may have to use dilute alkali, sometimes we may even use wastewater, as I said, brine, seawater, or you should be able to use wastewater, or if it is a fermentation broth, if you want to absorb oxygen from the air, there also this absorption is taking place, right? And for mostly for aerobic bioreactor, we have to supply oxygen from air into the system, which will be introduced in the form of bubbles into the fermenters. So that way that can be used, or even wastewater can be used to absorb oxygen from the air, right? And lime slurries are used sometimes diluted sulfuric acid or concentrated. So sometimes there may be reaction taking place along with the absorption, there can be reaction also. Okay, so in those cases we call it as absorption with chemical reactions. Okay, so you may have chemical reactions taking place along with the absorption. So for example, whenever you use this kind of concentrated acids or dilute alkalines, there may be chemical reaction taking place. Okay, and other than those things, we have absorption oils, particularly hydrocarbon oils are being used as the solvent. Okay, so that solvent, what is the role of the solvent? Solvent will that is a liquid solvent, will absorb one of the solute A from the gas. Okay, so that way it has to readily absorb one of the solvent. Selectively, it has to absorb one of the solute from the gas mixture. Okay, so that way these various solvents are being used industrially. So you can see there is a list available in the separation processes website. You have a different solute, that is to remove acetone, acetonitrile, ammonia, ethanol, formaldehyde, hydrochloric acid, sulfur dioxide, butadiene, carbon dioxide, naphthalene, chlorine, carbon dioxide, nitrogen dioxides. Water can be used as a solvent mostly, and there are some cases like hydrocarbons. We use hydrocarbon oils to absorb the solute. Here it is a solute A. Okay, so this is a species A. Okay, so these are the species to be removed. This is the absorbent, that is the liquid solvent. Okay, so these are the various liquid solvent which are being used to remove. And there is the absorption can be, as I said, it can be simply physical absorption, or sometimes there may be chemical reaction also taking place. So that chemical reaction also, so we have simply absorption without chemical reaction, or we have absorption with chemical reactions. Okay, so that chemical reaction can be sometimes reversible, sometimes there is irreversible chemical reaction also takes place. Okay, if it is reversible, then it is easier for us. So here in the absorption column, this reaction will take place to get this thing. If it is reversible, in desorption column, it is easier to separate out. Okay, so that is the advantage we have if it is a reversible reaction. Okay, so reversible chemicals are there. We can, when you use this absorbent, some reversible chemical reaction also takes place. Okay, so that is pretty easy to separate also. And there are some cases where we come across absorption with irreversible chemical reactions, like listed out here. Okay. And if you compare what is physical and what is chemical absorption, physical absorption, as the name indicates, they are temporary in nature. So as I showed you earlier, all the absorption columns are liquid that is leaving will be sent back to the desorption column, right? So every absorption column will be followed by a desorption column. So the liquid solvent which is rich in A will go into this desorption column, where we will separate out A, solute A again, and this whatever the liquid that is recovered will be sent back to the main column. Okay, that is less A, so liquid free of A will be sent back. Okay, so sometimes we may have to mix it with fresh solvent. So a mixture of fresh as well as recycled solvent, the liquid solvent, will be entering the absorption column, whereas the gas will enter and leave here like this. Okay, so for desorption to take place, so the whatever it is, when chemical reaction is there, the reverse of the same has to be carried out in a regeneration unit, where we essentially recover, either it can be, as I said earlier, it can be a stripping section where we want to recovery, solvent recovery process, or it can be recovery of the precious solute. The solute may be precious. In that case, we want our solute is the primary, solute is of the primary interest. Okay, recovery of the solute is the primary interest. Okay, so as I said earlier, either when you are using this alkaline or strong base or strong acid for absorption, in those cases some chemical or some reactive absorption will take place. The examples are, so for process for absorbing carbon dioxide and H2S with aqueous solution of MEA, monoethanol amine or diethanol amine or triethylene glycols or triethylene glycols. In these cases, reversible chemical reactions takes place in the liquid phase. So some absorption is associated by chemical reactions also. Okay, so that may be exothermic reaction. Okay, chemical reactions can increase because obviously when there is reaction is taking place, the rate of absorption is going to be increased. Okay, that means the increased absorption capacity of the solvent increases the selectivity to preferentially dissolve only one of the component of the gases. And moreover, we are converting a more hazardous chemical to a safe compound. Okay, that's why I showed you the example of ozone oxidation. Okay, there we are NOx is converted to NO2 or SOx is converted to more safe chemicals. Okay, so that can be used further. And what are the, if you coming to final theory part of this one, we have seen liquid solvent or absorbent. Okay, so the what is the selection criteria for choosing a liquid solvent, or other words, how we have to choose an absorbent for a given operation. Okay, so for that we will consider a mixture of A and B. Okay, so if you have a mixture of A and B, what happens when you are compressing it, they have, so we have solute A and solute B. Okay, so we have some liquid, we have A and B mixture. Okay, so we have a liquid here. What happens when you apply pressure here? So more amount of A, solute A, will get into the liquid. By applying pressure, we may increase this one. So, but after some saturation, at saturation, what happens? It cannot take any more liquid. Or we can say that the amount of A going from gas to liquid and again from liquid to gas will be in equilibrium. Okay, they will, the rate will become constant. Okay, so that way the net transfer will be zero. Okay, that is the amount of A entering and leaving are going to be same, so that when equilibrium is attained, so beyond which any more A cannot get dissolved into the one. So that is called as solubility. And another thing is volatility. So we are going to operate the system, when you are using the solvent, solvent will have some boiling point or it will have some volatile temperature, right? If it is highly volatile, there will be loss of solvent within the system. So that way the volatility, we have to, because solvent itself is more volatile, but we have to ensure that it is not highly volatile. Okay, so there should not be loss, it should be less volatile, so that there is less loss of solvent during the operations. Okay, and what about the viscosity of the solvent? If you look at the selection criteria of the viscosity, it should easily flow. We should not need extra pump or circulation of the liquid, or it should not get stuck anywhere. There should be laminar flow taking place. Okay, that means you should have low Reynolds number. So Reynolds number is rho Vd by mu, right? So we want a Reynolds number to be less, we want viscosity to be high or low. Viscosity is high, what will happen? Reynolds number will be less. So we have to choose viscosity such that we get nice flow and we don't need more resistance is not offered to the flow, right? So that it should easy to flow. That way we have to choose a liquid appropriately. Okay, and what about the corrosiveness of the solvent? It should not damage the absorption. Packing material may be there, right? If it is packed bed, or it may be a plate columns, right? We may have plate column or packed bed, whatever may be the case, either it may be plate column or it may be a packed bed, it should not corrode the, it should not damage the parts. So that way it should be inert to whatever system, either it is through the gas mixture or it is to the material of construction of the packed tower or plate tower. Okay, so for that it should be inert. So chemically it should be inert. Corrosiveness, it should not be corrosive in nature. What about the cost? Obviously it should be optimum. It should be, if it is cheap, if it is widely available, cost and availability is important factor. Because even though we may study that this solvent is very good, if it is not at all available, you have to import it. Government imposes a lot of international GST in importing that one. So that is very difficult to make use of it, right? So practically it should be available and it should be easily available also at lower cost. Okay, and with respect to hazard and toxicity, all the solvent needs to be stored in a storage tank. So in our industry, we need not spend a lot of extra money to take care of that one. So that way it should be less hazardous and toxic levels should be within limit, easily controllable. Okay, so obviously we have to take care of what is this smoke point, what is its fire point, flash and fire points, all that needs to be considered when storing this thing. Okay, so if that case, we may have to give them proper fencing if it is easily, if it can catch fire easily. Okay, so that way, to repeat, if it is a gas solubility, there are, it depends upon the two choices we have to choose the solvent. Our aim is to produce a specific solution. In that case, obviously water will be the solvent, because we want to recover HCl and make produce 0.05 normal HCl solution. Okay, so if that is the objective of performing this absorption column, obviously water will be used as a solvent. Whatever HCl present in the gas will be recovered, and finally we want to round the concentration to 0.05 normal HCl solution. So in that cases, water will be obviously the solvent. But whereas our aim is not to recover HCl, but in this desorption unit, I want to remove this HCl and get back my original solvent, whatever solvent I used, even if it is water, we want to recover water. That is my primary thing. I don't bother about the pollutant A which is being recovered. So in that case, we have many choices possible. Based on the choices, first thing we have to see is gas solubility. With the gas solubility should be high, because per liter of solvent I should be able to recover so much grams of solute. It should be recovered by a 1 liter of solvent. Okay, so that means less volume, more amount of solute A is recovered, means that is more preferable, right? So that way, that means what, this A should be readily soluble in the given solvent. The solvent that we choose for a given operation, out of the mixture A, B, C, D, only A should dissolve into it. B should not readily dissolve into this one. That way, except A, no other component should be readily soluble in the given solvent. That is also important parameter. Okay, and if a chemical reaction of the solvent with the solute may result with high gas solubility, but if you want to recover it to be reused, the reaction must be reversible. That's what I explained to you earlier. If it is irreversible reaction, whatever solvent used, we cannot separate out from the solute that is absorbed into it, because some reaction has taken place, it is irreversible reaction. So that way, if any reaction is taking place, that is welcome. But only thing we have to ensure is the reaction must be reversible. Okay. If you consider caustic soda absorbs H2S excellently, but it will not release it easily during the desorption operation. Okay. So I explained earlier, volatility, you should have a low vapor pressure to reduce loss of solvent. Okay. Corrosiveness, I told you, it should not be, the material of construction required for the equipment should not be unusual or expensive. Okay, the solvent should be, obviously it should be inexpensive, and that any, so that losses are not costly and should be readily available also. Okay, available nearby. Okay, we cannot import the solvent, so in that case it should be readily available, right? And about the viscosity, if it is low viscous, because the rapid absorption rate will be there, it will improve flooding characteristics in the packed column. Okay, so low pressure drop will be during the pumping will be there, right? Because we have seen that pressure drop per unit length in the piping is 32 mu u by d. Okay, so that way it is proportional to, it affects the pressure drop. So higher the viscosity, higher will be the pressure drop. Okay. And what about the other properties? It should be non-toxic, it should be non-flammable, and more chemically inert to the reaction mixtures, or we can say the gaseous materials that are present in it. Okay, moving towards the material balance for a material balance in a absorption column, which we have already discussed and we have even solved that one. We can derive an expression for minimum L by G ratio. I told you that the liquid flow rate and gas flow rate in kg moles per hour is some particular ratio has to be maintained, right? So what is the minimum L by G ratio we have to maintain to make it practically possible for the gas absorption to take place? So for this, first we recall the equilibrium curve of versus Y versus X. Okay, so if we have Y versus X, we know it is the equilibrium curve. Okay, where m is the slope of the curve which follows y equal to mx, and this law constant m, right? So we may have a system with top and bottom conditions. So if we can plot them and we get the operating line, okay. So what is the minimum L ratio we can maintain so that we can have the absorption taking place, okay. So that we will derive an expression now, okay. So consider a, for this we'll consider an counter current absorption column. Please make this diagram in your notebook. So you consider an absorption column, okay. So where gas is entering, so let gas stream is entering from the bottom of the tower and leaves at the top of the tower. So the bottom conditions will represent with 1, top conditions will represent with 2. So if G1 is the gas flow rate, gas mixture flow rate, and Y1 is the mole fraction of solute, okay. So this is the solute mole fraction, okay. Similarly, the gas is leaving with at this location, so we denote it as G2 is the gas mixture. So here G1 is the gas mixture and Y2 is the mole fraction of solute, okay. Solute A is mole fraction. And similarly, from the top of the column we have liquid entering the system and leaving from the bottom of the column, okay. So then here, is it L1 or L2? What should be coming here? Is it L1 or L2? So it should be, yeah, it should be L2. And the mole fraction of solute A in the liquid, okay, mole fraction of, so we have mole fraction of solute A in the liquid. So L2 is the liquid solvent which is entering, okay. So mostly for all practical purposes we may be taking it to be negligible or zero, but if it is mentioned, that mole fraction is mentioned, then we may consider, okay. So some fraction value will be given, unless mentioned specifically. Mostly it will, if it is mentioned like pure solvent, okay, or you can say solute free solvent. So if it is mentioned in this way, obviously this mole fraction will be zero. So here L1 is the liquid solvent flow rate and X1 is the mole fraction of solute A in liquid solvent, okay. So what is happening here? So obviously there are 2 input and there are 2 outputs. So material balance we have already written, okay. So that we'll do it in notebook. So obviously what we are getting is, practically speaking, our operating condition is there. If you know the outlet Y condition, what could be the X1 value maximum? So what we are trying to get is X1 max. What could be the maximum value for X1? So that, physically speaking, in this graph, this point we know, top condition. Bottom condition is YB value. YB value is, you have Y1 value. We don't know what is X1, right? Practically, X1 maximum value possible is, from here we want to have an operating line here is, so this point where it is cutting the equilibrium curve. This is your equilibrium curve, Y equal to MX, right? So that line is your maximum X1 value. So for graphically, we can obtain X1 max value, okay? So graphically, what we have to do is, we have to plot the points of X2, Y2 in the graph. And Y1 value is your, Y1 value you will mark a dotted line, okay. So from this point, where the another point is YB, X1 value maximum. So that will be your X1 maximum value, where it is bisecting the equilibrium curve. So here you are going to have X1 max, Y1 value, right? This is Y1 actual, okay. Here also Y1 is your actual Y1 value. Now we always operate to have better driving force. We should know that if the operating line is away from the equilibrium curve, we have high driving force. When the driving force is high, mass transfer rate will be more. If it is close to the equilibrium line, we are going to have less driving force. I have told you always the example of eating. If your capacity is to take 10 dosa, if you are hungry, if you have not taken a single, you, the rate at which you are going to eat will be more. But if you already taken 9, the driving force is less because you are close to your equilibrium value. So recall that one. So when the operating line is close to equilibrium line, the driving force is less. Therefore, the rate is less. That is, you can say mass transfer is difficult. Okay, so we to make it more, or we may say that it may need infinity time to complete, right? I have taken already 9. So 10th one is close to my maximum capacity. So always I'm going to take lot of time to complete the 10th dosa, right? So that way it will take time. It may be not be economically possible. That's why we want to have an x1 actual value, which will be always less than your x1 max value. Okay. So that way your x1 actual value will be less than the x1 maximum value. So that depends upon your, this slope is L by G ratio. Operating line is nothing but L by G ratio, right? So that's why we are going to derive an expression for it now. Okay. So this is what I was trying to explain you. This we are considering in counter current diagram. So counter current absorption. So for counter current absorption, as I said, you can have an equilibrium line y equal to mx. Operating line is your combination between x1 y1 and x2 y2, which are extreme conditions, right? 2 refers to top conditions, 1 refers to bottom conditions. Okay, so that way x1 y1 is mole fraction of, here it is liquid, it will have x1, gas will have y1. At 2, we are going to have liquid will have x2. Gas will have y2, right? So that points is your operating lines in the graph of equilibrium curve x versus y. So when you plot x versus y, we can always plot the using Henry's law, we'll have equilibrium curve. Then we can plot the operating line. So we can find out the number of stages required or number of plates required that we'll discuss later. Right now, to derive what the slope is, nothing but L by G ratio, that we should know. Okay, so we can see that if it is co-current, our plot will be like this. Because co-current means the values are going to be different. So x1, y1, x2, y2, operating line will be looking in this fashion. So L by G will be minus slope will be there. But if it is co-current, counter-current, we'll have L by G is the ratio of this operating line. So we'll derive the expression now. So bottom conditions we know, or top conditions we know. So x1, y1 is your bottom conditions. x2, y2 are our top conditions. We have g1, l1 bottom conditions. g2, l2 top conditions, right? I am not repeating here. So we can start writing the material balance. So the overall material balance is, what are the inputs here? G1, L1. So G1 is your input. Here L2 is the input. G1 plus L2 is equal to G2 plus L1 is the output, right? So input equal to output when there is no chemical reaction taking place. Okay. And we have seen that for individual material balance for solute A is given by, so what are the corresponding values? So y1 g1 plus x2 l2 is equal to y2 g2 plus x1 l1, right? And we, for all these operations, we consider constant molal overflow operation, constant molal overflow assumption. What is constant molal overflow assumption is that L1, L2 equal to L and G1, G2 approximately equal to G, right? So then what will happen? We have Y1 minus Y2 into G is equal to L into X1 minus X2, okay? So what is L by G? L by G is equal to
y1 minus y2 by x1 minus x2. Okay, so this is the slope. This slope is the, this is your operating line equation. So L by G your operating line equation. Slope of the operating line is L by G, and from equilibrium line, what is that? Y by X equal to M. So that is the slope. So we have slope of operating line is L by G, slope of equilibrium line is M. Okay, so that is Y equal to MX. Okay, so here we can define one parameter which we will use it later. We define absorption factor is equal to L by G divided by M. So what is that? Slope of operating line divided by slope of equilibrium line is equal to L by MG, which is equal to absorption factor. Okay, so this will make use for your conditions. Okay, okay, so there is a limit for absorption factor. A value should be above this or below this. We will see it later. Okay, so here just recall, we are doing derivation for L by G minimum. So here we defined that absorption factor additionally. So we have L by G equal to this. We have, this is the equilibrium curve, right? So we have seen that, when we have seen that this point is your x1, x2, y2. Mostly x2 is zero means when it is pure solvent, we are going to have x2 here. So simply x2 comma y2 will come in this y-axis only, right? Y versus x. So we may have equilibrium curve like this. So what is the proper, we have seen that y1 value is fixed, right? y1 is the inlet condition, right? In the bottom of the column, G is having with y1. What is its corresponding x1 value? We will come to know. What is the maximum possible x1 value with different L by G ratios is? What is the possible feasible? We cannot have x1 value beyond its equilibrium value, right? So this way here we get x1 max. So graphically speaking, when x1 is x1 max, okay, when x1 is x1 max, we have L by G is minimum. This is the condition. Okay, when x1 is x1 max, L by G is minimum. So we have L by G minimum is equal to y1 minus y2 by x1 max minus x2. Okay, so this we will get L by G minimum. Okay, so now we have L by G actual is equal to 1.25 to 1.5 times L by G minimum. So for all physical purpose, as I said, it is practically, we may have, we need, if you want to achieve this x1 maximum, we may have to operate it for longer time, or the liquid flow rate has to be very low, right? So there are practically, it is may not be economical. So that way we will operate this L by G actual, which will be 1.25 to 1.5 times L by G minimum. Okay, so that will be fixed by our operators, because from experience and wisdom, or from manufacturer, we will have what should be our L by G actual. So obviously, if you refer to this graph, if you want to operate under this condition, this is your L by G. L by G minimum condition, okay, where it will bisect with the equilibrium curve. So we can always operate, let me say this is your minimum liquid flow rate. L is minimum, Okay, then we may operate it at L1, L2, L3, L4, which is somewhat greater than L1, which is greater than L2, which is greater than L3. So how we will have the equilibrium curve and the driving forces? We let it be the equilibrium curve. Okay, let it be my x2, y2 point. Okay, so this is my y1 line. Okay, so this line we have already drawn for. This is the line we have gone for L dash minimum, L minimum, right? So we have L minimum. So obviously, if for any other values greater than, if our x1, it is our x1 max, right? We get x1 max corresponding to the equilibrium curve, okay? Where it is bisecting, we will get the x1 max value. So any other value of x1, either here, 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 we are going to have different driving force. Let it be L1, L2, corresponding to L2, okay, corresponding to L3, L4. So if these points, if you are considering this point, so see that the driving force, I told you this is your operating line, this is your equilibrium line. The away from the equilibrium, maximum is the gap. If the gap is maximum, we have high driving force for mass transfer. Okay, for mass transfer, even in the heat transfer, that is the same. When temperature difference is too high, the rate of mass transfer with the heat transfer will be high. Okay, so when these operating curves of L by G, so here L by G ratio will be different, right? So what we will have is, we will get x1 actual value corresponding to it. Okay, so from this, we will get what is your, so when you get L by G actual, what is the, once L by G actual is 1.5 times L by G minimum, okay, so which you have obtained from the graph. Okay, so what you will get, again we can substitute L by G actual is equal to same driving, what is the driving force, y1 minus y2 by x1 actual minus x2. So from this we will get the value of x1 actual. Okay, from the graph we will get the value of x1 actual. So once we get the x1 actual value, what we will do is, so we have already have the equilibrium curve y equal to mx. We already determined the corresponding value of y1, okay, so we have x2, y2. So what we have to do is, we have to mark this point as P. Let us mark this point x1 actual as M, okay, let P is x2 comma y2 and M is x1 actual comma y1. Then what we have to do is, we have to join PM. Join PM, so that is our operating line equation. So that is our operating line. If you join PM, PM is our operating line. Okay, so once we join PM, what we get is operating line, which will have the slope of L by G actual. With a slope L by G actual value, right? So that way, what we have to do is, here we have to join our PM. So once we join our PM, we have this one, okay? Okay, so once we know the x1 actual value, as explained here, now we get the x1 value actual from the graph, from the y1 dotted line versus equilibrium line, we get the corresponding value, corresponding y1 value correspondingly to Henry's law equation y equal to mx. That way also we can get x1 max. x1 max is equal to y1 divided by m.
will also give you the value. Otherwise, after plotting the graph, we will get this point is x1 max value. Okay. Because this is corresponding to this value, where this y1 value coincides with this y equal to mx, we get this one, right? So that way x1 max is equal to y1 by m. If in this value is given, you can get the x1 max value directly. Otherwise, we have to plot this x1 max value, substitute in this equation to get what is L by G minimum. So we have y1 minus y2 by x1 max minus x2 equal to L by G minimum. Then we'll get L by G actual equal to 1.25 times 1 by L by G max minimum. So then we will get L by G actual. Once we get the L by G actual, we'll again substitute in y1 minus y2 by x1 actual minus x2 will give us the x1 actual value. So once we get the x1 actual value, we get the point M. So that point M is x1 actual, okay, comma y1. So once we plot this M, we will join P and M. So joining P M, what we get is the operating line. So once we get the operating line, how to get number of stages required is, so this is our top condition, right? So x2, 2 is our top condition, 1 is our bottom conditions, right? So how many number of stages are required, how to determine is, so we will start from this one. Again, I will plot here separately. So we have equilibrium curve, okay, and we have just plotted our operating line equation, okay. So how to get is, so from here we get x2, y2, right? We'll draw a line parallel to x-axis, and again we'll draw a line parallel to y-axis. So that will give us the number of required stages. We have to pass through the point. Okay. For example, so when the driving force is high, we need less number of stages. But if we have a case where we have equilibrium curve and we have an operating line very close to your this is your PM, where we have x2 comma y2, x1 comma y1, x1 actual, because x1 maximum will be here, right? So this is your y1 line. Okay, so how many number of stages are required if it is very close to your equilibrium curve? Your number of stages required will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we need 5 number of theoretical stages. Plates are stages. Okay, so this is how we will determine the number of theoretical stages required. And for each, if plate efficiency is given, stage efficiency or plate efficiency, it can be a fraction, like similar to efficiency of the pump. It can vary between, let me say, 0.2 to 0.9 or 0.5. Whatever is the value, we will get number of actual stages equal to, because number of actual plates required, number of actual plates is equal to number of theoretical plates by efficiency. Efficiency is, let me say, 0.5. Okay, so number of plates I obtained is 5 divided by 0.5. So what you will get? You will get 50% efficiency, means we have to get double number, right? 10 number of actual stages is required for a given separation. For a given separation, we need 10 number of actual plates. So that's where we make use of plate efficiency in determining the number of actual stages required. Okay, so what we have done, we first to find out x1 max value, then we found x1 actual value. Once we find x1 max value, we found L by G minimum value. From L by G minimum value, we got L by G actual value. Once we got x1 actual value, we plotted P and M in the graph. So this is x1 actual comma y1 value. We have joined PM. Okay. Then what we did is step up from P to M,
Okay, so stepping up is like drawing horizontal lines and vertical lines. Okay, horizontal line to x-axis, vertical line to y-axis. Okay, so and you have determined the number of steps. So once you find the number of steps, that is our theoretical steps. Okay, so once we got the theoretical steps, if you know the efficiency, we can get, if efficiency is known, or even you can assume it to be 50% or 25%, so the number of actual stages can be determined. Number of actual stages can be determined. Okay, so what I have done it in terms of L by G and small x comma y. Okay, so like I explained you for NTU HTU problems, the same can be written in terms of L dash and G dash and capital X comma capital Y. What is capital X capital Y? They are mole ratio. Okay, so can we rewrite the equation? If we write the equation in terms of mole ratios, and what is L dash is solute free liquid. G dash is solute free gas mixture. It is binary, simply gas. Or some textbook will use L subscript S, G subscript S. Okay, so whatever it is solute free liquid or solute free gas. And how they are related, in yesterday's class itself, last lecture number 30 itself, we have seen G dash is equal to G into 1 minus Y. Okay, L dash is equal to L into 1 minus X. So if you want G dash value at 1, G1 dash is equal to G1 into 1 minus Y1. Okay, remember G1 dash or G2 dash going to be same, that we should know. G2 into 1 minus Y2. But G1, G2 will be different. G dash will be different because whatever is the amount of solute free gas entering will be leaving also. So that way we have G1 dash is equal to G2 dash. So that way we simply write only G dash only. We don't write G1 dash, G2 dash. But whereas G1 is different, G2 is different because G1 and G2 are different because we have different mole fraction here. Okay. So that way we can relate to mole ratio. Similarly, if you are considering this column in terms of G dash, then we have capital Y1, we have G dash and capital Y2 as the mole ratio. Similarly, we have L dash with capital X1, sorry, upper condition is 2, right? Always remember we have to make uniform thing. Then you have L dash and capital X1. So what will be the material balance? If you want to write, L dash by G dash is equal to Y1 minus Y2 by X1 minus X2. So what is L dash? L dash by G dash minimum is capital Y1 minus Y2 by X1 max minus X2. Okay. So the plot we are going to make use of is equilibrium curve, capital X versus capital Y. Okay, so the operating line we will be using is going to be like this. Okay, so you'll get X1 max here. Our actual X1 max, actual X1 will be, we'll obtain here, right? So how to get X1? So L dash by G dash actual will be equal to 1.5 times L dash by G dash minimum. Remember, it can change, right? Any constant. Then from this L dash by G dash actual, you will get Y1 minus Y2 by X1 actual minus X2. Remember, this X2 will be zero for pure liquids or pure solvents. Okay, so from this we will get X1 actual value. So again, the procedure is same. Mark point M, mark point P, which is X2, Y2, mark point M, which is X1, Y1, join PM. Okay, step up from P until it crosses M. Okay, remember, when you are stepping up, my point is here, if I am getting steps like this, okay, so we have to consider another step. If the step is not completing at this point M, we have to consider another step. Okay, so until it crosses the M point, we have to consider that stage also. So that way we have to get the number of theoretical stages. Number of theoretical stages needs to be determined. Okay. So now we are ready to solve some numericals. Okay. So we'll do the numericals in the next lecture. Before that, I will just like to show you how we will get the number of stages. As I said, bottom condition is here. So bottom condition is here. Number one, this is 2, 3, 4, 5 until we cross this actual value, x1 actual value. Okay. So that way we find the number of theoretical stages required. Okay. And if you compare the absorption versus desorption, we should know what is absorption, desorption. Absorption is also called as scrubbing, whereas desorption is called as stripping. The operating line for absorption column, which is ratio of L by G, the slope is L by G. The operating line will come above the equilibrium line. Here the balance line is your equilibrium line. Okay, so the operating line for absorption column always lies parallel to your equilibrium curve if it is counter current operation, and it will be always above the equilibrium line. But if it is counter co-current operation, this slope will be minus L by G. That is the only difference. If it is co-current, you can do the material balance and try to get what is L by G. You are going to get only a slope which is perpendicular to your vertical equilibrium curve. So this line is positive slope. If you get opposite of it, negative slope if you get, that is your co-current absorption. Whereas for desorption, if it is counter-current desorption, we are going to have the operating line below the equilibrium line. So the operating line for desorption operation will be below the equilibrium line. So as I told you earlier, most of the absorption columns will be having a subsidiary unit which will be a desorption column, where we have to regenerate or we have to recover the solvent from the liquid which is coming out of the absorption column. So example is using methanolamine or ethanolamine, CO2 is absorbed from the synthesis gas, which is from a ammonia plant. So the objective may be we have to recover the CO2. So because the CO2 will be used as a raw material for a urea plant. Okay, so that will be sent to urea plant. CO2 is recovered and used to produce urea plant. Thereby we are not sending off the CO2 in the atmosphere. Number one. Number two objective is we are recovering the solvent which is being recycled. So this triethanolamine, this will be recovered and recycled into the system. Okay. Well, in this lecture, we have seen what is gas absorption, how gas absorption is carried out in industries, and what is the significance of this operation is discussed. And we have seen material balance and derivation for L by G ratio. And we have seen the basic operation, what is the phenomena that is taking place, how the solute A is diffusing from A to B, that it is following unimolecular diffusion. Right? It is an example for A diffusing through non-diffusive B. Okay, and we have seen what is the material balance in terms of L by G. Also, we have seen the material balance in terms of L dash G dash or LS GS, that is solute free gas and vapor flow rate, solute free liquid flow rate. Okay. And we have seen how to determine the operating line. What is the expression for operating line for a counter current gas absorption? And we have seen the same for L dash G dash also. Okay. And we have seen how to determine the number of theoretical stages required by graphical method. How to get x1 max value, how to get x1 actual, then how to get the L by G actual, and how to determine number of stages. And if after getting number of theoretical stages, if stage efficiency is known, how to determine the actual number of plates required for a gas absorption duty. Okay. And we have seen what are the selection criteria for solvents to for a given set of
gas absorption operation, and we have seen several examples for gas absorption in industries. Thank you so much for joining my classroom. Meet you in next lecture. Bye bye.